Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. In the name of Allah, the Clement, the Merciful. Hi viewers, I am your host, Professor Dr. Mazhar Ayaz from Veterinary Problems and Solution Channels, Cholistan University of Veterinary and Animal Sciences, Bahawalpur, Pakistan. Today, our topic of discussion is types of a host and parasitology. As you know, on the earth, there are hosts and variety of hosts are present, including mammals, birds, reptiles, fish, and insects. So all these hosts are present on the planet earth, and we will discuss about their types and how they are infected from the parasites. So that will be a quite bit healthy discussion and quite informative. I hope you will enjoy and learn from this. As you know that the field of parasitology is a multidisciplinary subject which embraces the field of biochemistry, physiology, pathology, cell biology, molecular biology, nanotechnology, biotechnology, and endocrinology, immunology, pharmacology, zoology, microbiology, reproduction, epidemiology, statistics, economics, artificial intelligence, and many more emerging fields which are used for the study of the parasites and host and their interaction, that is called parasitism in general. So we will study about the parasitology, and I hope the students from medical sciences and from veterinary sciences and from biological sciences will learn a lot of this things from this subject also. So we will be dealing with the parasites, with the host, and in general the parasitism. When we talk about the host in our daily life, then we think first that a person will call us on the dinner on the dining table. But in the term of parasitology, there is something special, that organisms that harbor some other organisms at its own expenses, and like food, and they offer shelter, and they offer conducive environment to reproduce or to grow and multiply, and that is called host, and in the parasitology especially. Sometimes the host can be the larger than the parasite, and any living organism on this earth, including mammals, insects, vertebrates, or invertebrates, can be work as a host. So it has a wide range, and many more explorations are required for the wide range of the hosts still to be explored from the scientists of various fields. Here you can see the variety of hosts from the wild and from the livestock, and also the human beings, they act as a host. Host can be the free living or the domesticated, on the earth and in the skies or under the seas. They can be everywhere, and there is a lot of exploration still to be done. As we have discussed that the various types of hosts are present on this planet Earth, so that can be the definite host or the final host or determinate host. So animal harboring the adult or sexually mature stage of the parasite is called their definite host or final host. We can give the example of Ankylostoma caninum, that is a hookworm of the dog, and also Fistula gigantica, Fistula hepatica, Munizia, Munizia expansa, Hemuncus contortus, that has a final host like sheep, goat, cattle, or buffalo. So these are the final hosts, or definite host, or determinate hosts. Here, these are the few examples. Here we can give the examples of Ankylostoma caninum, where that can be transmitted through the penetration of their larvae to the other hosts, including human beings, puppies, and also to the cats. They can penetrate are migrate through the skin and can be observed through their penetration or their ways. So here you can we can see the life cycle of Escherichia hepatica, where that is present in the liver of the sheep that grows on the marshy area, and the definite host or the final host is sheep in this regard, the Escherichia hepatica, and intermediate host is the snail. So these are the few examples of this intermediate host. So next is the dead end host. That is a host where parasite is trapped and cannot escape, or they cannot be transmitted to any other host or any other animals. So the example is Escherichia hepatica in human beings, when they accidentally are engulfed through the contaminated liver or through contaminated water or eating any contaminated snail or mollusks. So they are trapped in the human beings and they cannot be transmitted to any other or animals. So that human being is the dead end host. So this is the example of dead end host. And similarly, Echinococcus granulosus, that is a tapeworm mostly found in the dogs. So when they accidentally come into the human beings and they form cysts in the liver, in the lungs, in the brain, and sometimes in other organs of the body, including their kidneys. So that is called the dead end host of the Escherichia hepatica, and that this is the Echinococcus granulosus in the human beings. So human beings are the dead end host. But sometimes when the sheep or cattle eat the contaminated grass from the Echinococcus granulosus, they can also sometimes are transmitted through their offals to the other animals, including crows, the fox, and similarly other scavengers. Now we will discuss about the principal host, that is a host in which the parasite is most commonly found. And the example here we can give the Trichinella spiralis, that is most commonly found in the pigs, and that is associated with the pork products. So the principal host is the pork, and after eating the pork products, the human beings become the host. So this is the example about the principal host. Next, we will talk about the supplementary host or the host of secondary importance. In the tapeworms, especially in the tapeworms of the pigs, the two hosts, especially primary host is the human beings, and the intermediate or secondary host or supplementary host is the pig. And mostly they form the water-filled in the muscles or the cysts in the muscles or in the body of the pigs. So they act as a supplementary host. Next is the experimental host. Mostly this host is present in the labs or laboratories, where sometimes infection cannot be found or studied in natural environment. So we perform this activity on the experimental host, including rabbits, rats, mouse, and sometimes on the monkeys, and we study their natural way of infecting. How do they infect? What are their life cycles? And how they spread in the body? So that is done only in the experimental host for the study purpose or for the research purpose, and they'll help us to make or prepare vaccines or for the therapeutic trials. Is the intermediate host. The intermediate host is animal in which development occurs but in which adulthood is not reached. So it can be the first, second, or third intermediate host, and example can be given in the role of snails in the trematodes or flukes, where that acts as the first or second or third intermediate host. And in this picture you can also see how that disease is transmitted to the sheep. If this mollusks are absent, then the disease could not be established in the animals also. Next, how we can see here, the life cycle of trematodes are flukes. They are the adult flukes. Then they mature or immature. Then there is mericidium, and that mericidium is taken up by the snails or mollusks, and then they release the sporocyst and radia, cercaria, and that cercaria is taken up again. The second intermediate host, sometimes that can be crustaceans, that can be snails, plants, or fish, and finally they are taken up by the host, final host, that can be the human being, that can be the animals like horse, like sheep, goat, cattle, buffalo, etc. So next is the first intermediate host. We will discuss about the first intermediate host, that in which the host is parasitized by the larvae. Stages of the parasites, for example, the cyclopes in the Diplobothrium latum. Cyclopes are the small creatures present in the water, so they take up the Diplobothrium eggs, and when they are taken up by the fish or sometimes accidentally by the human beings, so that disease is transmitted, and this is the dwarf worms. So next is the second intermediate host. The second intermediate host is the host which parasitized by the larval stages at a later period in the life cycle, and that develop in the first intermediate host. The larval stages in this host further develop and normally reach to the infective stages of the parasite. For example, fish for the Diplobothrium latum and ants for the Dicrocelium dendriticum. They act as a second intermediate host. Here we can see the example of Dicrocelium dendriticum, how that fluke can reach to the human beings or to the ants, where they become infected, and sometimes they use stargazing term, where the ants come on the branches of the trees and they look at the stars, and finally they die. So this is, and they, here in the under, we can see the example how the Dicrocelium dendriticum infected ants are taken up by the grazing animals, including horses and the sheep, and how they are infected. Then is the reservoir host, animal that harbor the species of parasite that can be transmitted to and infect man, and that parasite is found naturally without harming the reservoir host. And we can give the examples of Blantidium coli that is commonly present in the pigs and in the horses. The next one is the reservoir host. The reservoir host is that animal that harbors a species of parasite that can be transmitted to another animals or mammal or other host and can infect man, and that parasite is found naturally without harming the reservoir host. The example can be given the Blantidium coli that are present mostly in pigs and horses and that cause intestinal infection in human beings. So here that can be given as a parasite host or reservoir host. Next is the peritonic host or accidental host. It is like the transport host, but in this case the immature stage of the parasite gets encapsulated in the tissue of the host, hence they cannot be voided out and remains encysted until the definite host eats the peritonic host. For example, lizards, they act as a peritonic host for the Spirocercalupi that cause a disease in the dogs. And the role of such hosts is to fill up an ecological gap between the intermediate host and the definite host. Here, in the above picture, we can see the fish as a peritonic host for a certain larva that are present in an A fish and B fish is being infected. Next, this is the life cycle of Spirocercalupi. Here, we can see the dung beetles, the lizards, and the frogs and mouse. They act as a peritonic host for this Spirocercalupi. And here this life cycle is present in fox also. They are infected by the dung beetles, and the dung beetles are taken up by the lizards, and that infected lizards are taken up by the these foxes and the coyotes. Next is the carrier host or reservoir host, a host that harbors a parasite but exhibits no clinical signs or symptoms. Here we can see the example of flavivirus. The birds are reservoir for the West Nile virus, and mosquito acts as a vector for both diseases and also for the dengue fever. So they can be transmitted to the human beings as well as to the non-human primates like monkeys. So here the vector, they act as a carrier host, and sometimes these birds act as a carrier host or reservoir host. Then is the vector host, a host in which a part of parasite life takes place for the transmission of disease to other organisms or vertebrates, and their role is like a mosquito that plays in the transmission of Plasmodium. So they can transmit malaria to the human beings and to the other animals, and that mosquito can act as a biological vector, and because they suck the blood. And other is the mechanical vector, like flies, they transmit amoeba to the other human beings. So this is a vector host that can be observed. And similarly, we can also observe a foresty. It is a temporary relationship in which one is not benefited nutritionally but only by transport or by shelter. Here we can give the example of soldier fly that carries the red mites. And also there is an example of the cecal worm Hetericus gallinarum, that larva or eggs are contaminated by the Histomonas blegridus, that is a protozoa, and these eggs or larvae can act as a transport host, and they cause a black head disease that is a very devastating disease in the turkeys, and that contains a black head disease, and that contaminated fecal material or these Hetericus gallinarum eggs are taken up by the earthworms, and that infected or carrier earthworm is eaten up by the turkeys or chickens, and in the same way the two different diseases are simultaneously caused in these animals. So that here the cecal worm and then the earthworm, they act as a foresty. The classes of host can be the definite or primary host, and paratenic host or reservoir host, an intermediate host or secondary host, and sometimes there can be the additional host also for the completion of the life cycle. So there we can study another thing, that is a quantitative host spectrum. This gives the amount of infection present in each infected species, and that depends upon their geographic locations, the climate during the season, the ground cover, the distribution of acceptable intermediate host, whether they are present or not, and found in abundance or not, and chronological time, at which part of the day or which part of the night or which part of the year they can be found. Then ethnology or habitation of the host, whether that host is present or not. This is the quantitative host spectrum. Here you can find the references. I hope you have enjoyed this, and there might be some informations. Thank you very much for your viewing and for your patience. I hope you will like and subscribe this channel.